Introduction to Academic Conference Posters. Posters are visuals and text in interesting and creative ways to tell the story of research. Posters are becoming a popular assessment method in higher education. Posters have become an important part of conferences, seminars, and exhibitions. Some of the things that you must consider when creating an academic poster is the planning. Then you have to think about the audience awareness, the layout of your poster, your design, the images that you will use, and the contents of the text. Finally, the final checks before you submit your poster. So, why do a poster presentation? It allows you to personally interact with people who are interested in your research area. Interested audience can still view your poster even if you are not there. Studies have shown that learners who are in standing position are often more engaged compared to a seated audience. Poster sessions do not have time constraints, and it enables you to present information visually. Let's take a look at how to create an academic poster in more detail. It is important to be able to communicate your work and ideas effectively using a variety of presentational methods. Posters can be a useful medium in scientific communication and are regularly used in presentations at meetings and conferences. They are static, visual displays that enable you to directly discuss your work and receive instantaneous feedback. Although it is assumed that the poster will do most of the talking, it is the role of the presenter to answer questions and explain the work in further detail. A successful poster will not only attract a viewer's attention, but will also outline accurately and concisely the aims, workings, and conclusions of your scientific research. Here are some suggested guidelines to help you prepare a successful and effective poster.
So a couple of tips I have. One is you do not want to be nervous at all. Basically, the judges look for professionalism, they look for how well you can communicate, and being nervous will completely basically turn the judges off from what you're trying to say. And a way that you can avoid being nervous is you just practice a lot. Two, you want to tell a story with your poster. So you don't want to just come up here and start talking about science. You want to tell the judges who you are, what your work is, why you picked that work, what you did, and how you did it. And by making that sort of personal connection, the judges will really feel like, one, they know you, and they'll be able to really understand what you're talking about at a deeper level. The third thing is actually goes into the poster design itself. You want to label everything really consistently and make sure you have nice graphs. So the main thing I hear judges tell other people when they're judging their posters is that they can't read their graphs. So by having everything really nicely laid out, it makes it easy for them to understand what you're saying, and it makes it easy for them to get the idea that you're trying to explain. Fourth has to do with the writing itself, basically. You want to write really concisely and a really short summary of every section of your poster. If you have a really popular poster, or if someone's too far away to hear what you're saying, it's really a big advantage for them to be able to read it and ask you questions after. And basically the last thing is to use your poster to your advantage. The whole reason you made this poster is so you can communicate science to them. And by actually coming over here and saying, okay, this diagram means this, if you have to go up really close and point to each thing, that's fine, as long as they know what you're talking about. And that's basically it. So to sum it up, one, don't be nervous. Two, you want to tell a story about your poster, basically why you did everything and who you are. Three, you want to make sure everything is labeled really consistently and especially focus on your graphs, because that's a big downfall for a lot of people. Four is everything you write, you want to make it really concise. And basically five, you want to actually use your poster to tell the story, to amplify what you're saying. Thank you. Why is you so gung-ho? Cause I believe this was meant to be. I just gotta work at it like a crack addict up in rehab. In my arms, in my mind, all the time. I wanna keep you right by my side till I die. I'm gonna hold you down and make sure everything is right with you. You can never go wrong if you let me hold you. Now I can...
For the content, determine how large your poster will be and how much space you have allocated. Once you know this, you can begin to work out how much information you can include. The purpose of a poster is not to simply stick every single bit of information you have on board, but to be succinct and clear in what you are trying to present. Be clear as to the message that the poster is presenting so that relevant results are presented and discussed. Think about your audience and what you are trying to achieve with your poster, as this will help to determine your poster style. For example, posters that are conveying a simple message, for example, billboards and poster campaigns, tend to be very visual with a non-technical content. By comparison, scientific posters will have a more detailed and complex content. Typically, a poster should contain a title section, abstract or summary, short introduction, aims and objectives, methodology, results, discussion and conclusions. You may also want to include a section detailing suggestions for further work. You could recommend how your work could be developed or suggest other tests that could be applied. Keep your title short and to the point so as to grab the attention of the viewer. The title section should also include the names of the people involved in the work. Be selective in the results you include in your poster. Display only those representing the main findings of your work. You can always keep other results close to hand in case you are asked about them. Use figures to present data in a concise form, like showing trends, but refer to figures where they support the text. The conclusion of your poster should be the climax of your work and needs to address the main aims and objectives of the project. When it comes to the layout and format, it is very important that the text and data included in your poster follow a logical and hierarchical order. When we approach new information, we tend to read from top to bottom and from left to right. Therefore, it makes good sense to lay your work out in this order. You could, for example, place your abstract in the top left corner and the conclusions in the bottom right corner. Remember that the poster should be able to lead the reader through the work presented. An alternative layout to the one described is to place the conclusion in the center of the poster and have the supporting work radiating out from it. It may be helpful to provide arrows that direct attention to the sequence and order of the presentation. Excessive argumentation, however, can be distracting and confusing. Keep the column width at a size that is easy to scan. Try not to present long and detailed sections of text. Bullet points can often be more effective and will maintain the reader's interest. Images, graphs, and photographs. If used in the correct way, graphics and visual images can greatly enhance your poster, increasing both understanding and interest. However, ensure that all graphics are relevant to your work and linked by references, figures, numbers in the text. Make sure that all diagrams are clearly captioned and easily seen. For example, a micrograph should be around 120 to 80 mm in size. Captions should be positioned below the diagram figure, and the figure should be placed close to the relevant text. Whenever possible, captions on graphs and diagrams should read horizontally. The exception to this is the vertical axis label on a graph. When it comes to style, keep it simple, clear, and concise. Obviously, the poster needs to be eye-catching and attractive, but filling up your poster space with excess clutter can be distracting for the viewer. Ensure that your font size is large enough to be legible from at least a meter away. Example, 16 to 18 for the text and 24 to 36 for titles. Individuals will soon tire of having to lean in or squint to read small text. Try to use one or two font types at most. Too many font types can look messy and confusing, particularly if they are in the same sentence or paragraph. It is best to choose fonts that are easy on the eye, such as Times New Roman or Arial. Use caps and lowercase instead of all caps for easier reading. Maintain a consistent style throughout. Do it like me, though. So don't do it like me, folk. I seen you try to do it like me. Man, that damn was ugly. Soldier boy, I'm in it. Oh. Why me crack it? Why me roll? Why me crack that soldier boy? That Superman. That, oh. Now why me crack that soldier? Now why me you crack that soldier? Now why me you crack that soldier? Now why me you crack that soldier? Now why soldier boy, I'm in it. Oh. Why me crack it? Why me roll? Why me crack that? When it comes to color, using colors on your poster is a useful way of attracting attention and can give your work impact. However, be careful to use color sparingly and with discretion. Too many colors or borders can be distracting and look untidy. Try to avoid bright, noisy, or clashing colors. A good tip is to use background and foreground colors that complement each other and have high contrast. This will ensure that your text and images will stand out. If you are using colored text, make sure that it contains with the background paper, as it can be frustrating for the viewer to search for the text that appears camouflaged. You are the reason why my head is still above water. And if I could, I'd get you. More information on academic poster presentation. Now that you've pretty much understood the steps to creating a poster, by understanding the selection of content, deciding on layout and design, you will need to edit and proofread your poster before submission. Your title should convey what your research is about, highlighting the subject and scope of the study. It should be clear and attractive or attention-grabbing to reel in more audience. The title should summarize the paper's content in a few words. Regarding the title of your poster, it should capture readers' attention and increase visibility. Which is better? Let's decide on one. Which title, in your opinion, is better? Number 1, the impact of English subtitles in English movies as a teaching tool to improve English language in secondary school. Or number 2, improve English by watching English movies in classrooms. To me, the title Improve English by Watching English Movies in Classroom appear more appealing. In your condensed abstract, it should introduce the study by describing the content and explain why the research is important. Other than that, it should describe the purpose of the study and report how the study was carried out. It should summarize important findings, explain what is important and why, and keep the length within 150 to 200 words for the poster. Please see the following example of a condensed abstract for a poster presentation. In your introduction section, announce your topic. Provide some background to create the context and rationale on why your research is worth reading. Like the condensed abstract, it should also be approximately 150 to 200 words in length. You can capture the reader's interest by setting the right tone of the research. The research objectives or research questions describe what the researcher expects to find at the end of the research. The research objective must correspond to the content of the poster. It should be brief and concise, follow a logical sequence, use action words that can be measured, evaluated, like to identify, to investigate, to determine, or to compare. Example of research objectives are as follows. Number one, to identify the linguistic features used by female and male workers in work-related conversations at workplace. Number two, to determine the functions of tag questions and fillers used in conversations between male and female workers. The methods section describes and justifies the steps you had followed in conducting your research. It addresses the question of how was the data collected and how was the data analyzed. You may also use flowcharts to illustrate the research method and design used. These elements must be included in your research method. Overview of research, qualitative or quantitative approach, sample size, location, instrument, procedure, and data analysis. The results section should include key findings of the study. Use non-textual visuals such as tables, charts, graphs to present the findings effectively. Rather than writing out the findings descriptively, it is best to put the findings in the form of a graphical representation. Here are some examples. Your conclusion should restate the main purpose of the research, draw together the key findings and synthesize the arguments you have made, and come to a clear conclusion. Example for conclusion. Majority of the commuters were willing to use public transportation, especially the light railway transit and monorails, but were unhappy with the current situation. The findings conclude that commuters were willing to use public transports if more frequent feeder buses were provided to and from the LRT stations if the fares were reduced. For the reference or citation section, use an APA style formatting. Include only the reference cited in the poster. Make a list in a separate column. You may use in-text citation and reference list in the poster. Here are some examples of posters. Tips on layout and design. When you are ready to edit and proofread your poster, there are a few questions to consider. Is the poster reader-friendly? Is the title short and attention-grabbing? Are the methods used well explained and understandable? Do the objectives of the study correspond with the content of the poster? Is the language used error-free? And is the take-home message in the poster clear? To recap, this is what you have learned in delivering a poster presentation.
I've been moving calm, don't start no trouble with me. Trying to keep it peaceful is a struggle for me. Don't pull up at 6 a.m. to cuddle with me. You know how I like it when you loving on me. I don't wanna die for them to miss me.
Yes, I see the things that they wishing on me. Hope I got some brothers that outlive me. They gon' tell the story was different with me. God's plan, God's plan. I hold back, sometimes I won't, yeah. I feel good, sometimes I don't, hey, no. I finesse down Western Road, hey, next. Might go down to G-O-D, yeah, wait. I go hard on Southside G, yeah, wait. I make sure that Northside E. And still, bad things. It's a lot of bad things that they wish and they wish and they wish and they wish and they wishing on me. Bad things. It's a lot of bad things that they wish and they wish and they wish and they wish and they wishing on me. Yeah. Hey, hey. She say, do you love me? I tell her only partly. I only love my bed and my mom. I'm sorry. 50 dub, I even got it tatted on me. 81, they'll bring the crashers to the party. And you know me, turn the 02 into the 03, dawg. Without 40 Ollie, there be no me. Imagine if I never met the broskies. God's plan, God's plan. I can't do this on my own, ayy, nope, ayy. Someone watching it close, yup, yeah, close. I've been me since Scarlet Road, ayy, bro, ayy. Might go down as G-O-D, yeah, wait. I go hard on Southside G, ayy, wait. I make sure that Northside E, yeah. And still, bad things. It's a lot of bad things that they wishing and wishing and wishing and wishing they wishing on me. Yeah. Yeah. Bad things. It's a lot of bad things that they wish and they wish and they wish and they wish and they wishing on me. Yeah.
Every year at hotels all over the world, scientists from every field in science flock to these giant academic conferences. They're like Woodstock for geeks in that field. Scientists go to these conferences to learn about the new research going on in their field and to share the work they're doing with everybody else and to drink and hang out with friends from other universities who they don't get to see very often. So it's like a big social knowledge update for the whole field. And at most all of these conferences, there's something called a poster session. And poster sessions are where researchers share findings that didn't fit into bigger sessions or bigger presentations. Scientists take some new research finding, some new truth about the world, and they try to explain it on this giant poster. These poster sessions are one of the main ways that scientists share knowledge with each other, and they have the potential to be this really great experience for both the person presenting the poster and the person walking around looking at all the posters. But in reality, scientists have mixed feelings about poster sessions. A lot of us go into poster sessions feeling like kind of optimistic, and then we come out feeling like disappointed and underwhelmed. And here's why. First, here's what it feels like to present a poster. If you're going to be the person presenting the poster, you're first thinking like, oh, this will be great. I'll put all this work that I'm really passionate about on this big, beautiful poster, and people will walk by it and be like, oh, cool research. And I'll be like, oh, you think so? Let's talk about it. And then we'll have this really engaging conversation where like I learn things and they learn things, and other people will walk by and be like, oh, great research. And they'll get to learn what I'm doing. And I'll feel like I'm getting to share what I'm doing with the world and with other scientists. And sometimes, like very, very rarely, you will get like half of that experience. But that's the best case. Most of the time, you're standing by your poster all eager, while people just walk by you and don't even look at your poster as if you don't exist, while you try to like stare them down out of desperation, like, please someone, respond to my work. And then the whole hour of the poster session goes by and no one has even, not just engaged with your poster, but no one has looked at your poster. And then you just take your poster down and you look at it and you remember that it cost $100 to print, and then you throw it away. And then you think, maybe my research wasn't that interesting anyway, and that was a complete waste of time. Now, here's how it feels to attend a poster session. The experience of attending a poster session and walking around trying to learn from all the posters can be even worse than it is for the presenter. Okay, it's not worse than it is for the presenter. Nothing's worse than presenting a poster session, but it's still pretty bad. Again, you start off with very high hopes. You picture yourself walking through and like breathing in all the latest research in your field, learning stuff you never thought to think about before, and really just like getting more enlightened as a scientist and getting all new ideas for the stuff you're doing. But it never, ever works out that way. In reality, most of the time you walk in and there's all these presenters standing there by all their posters, and they're like locking eyes with you and watching you as you pass because they're also bored and desperate for you to engage with them and like validate their research. Then their posters are just like walls of incomprehensible text that you can't interpret very quickly. So what you do is you kind of like avoid the too intense eye contact of the presenters while trying to quickly and surreptitiously scan the titles of the posters, trying to get an idea of one or two you might want to check out. And the title of the poster just sort of gives you a general idea of what the study did, like the research question they asked, not even the answer. And it's kind of abstract and a little too technical, but if you can get the general idea, then maybe you engage with the poster and try to get closer and try to figure out what they did and try to learn something. So you found a poster that you're kind of interested in, and you walk up closer to get a general idea and scan it and read it and try to learn the core insight from it. But while you're doing that, the desperate presenter who's standing like 2 feet away from you and staring at you notices you looking at their poster, and they're like, any questions? Any questions? Let me know if you have questions! And then you feel like you want to be polite, so you talk to the presenter. And maybe you have a pretty good conversation, and you learn about what's on the poster, and you eventually learn that key punchline of the study after you've asked a bunch of follow-up questions. But you end up staying at the poster longer than you need to, even past the point of learning what you wanted from it, because you're in a conversation, you don't want to be rude and just cut the presenter off. But meanwhile, like, this is taking a lot of time. You usually have less than an hour to browse all the posters, and that's if you showed up on time, which you didn't. So the minutes are going by while you're having this conversation and doing all these social niceties and trying to figure out a polite way to exit the conversation. And usually after just one of these conversations, you realize that time is limited, and you've got to like skim harder and avoid eye contact harder. So you breeze through the rest of the posters, maybe stop at one more, but you're really, really desperately skimming now. So you're forced to adopt a strategy where you spend a lot of time at one or maybe even two posters, maybe even past the point where you've gotten the insight you wanted, and then you've used up most of your time, so you have to skip around and breeze through the rest of the posters and barely even read the titles. And then you leave the poster session feeling a little disappointed and uneasy, but still trying to convince yourself that it was productive. Like, oh, I'm super glad I spent 35 minutes talking about that one poster that I wasn't even super interested in. That was a good use of my time. It was. I'm sure there was nothing on any of the other posters that was remotely relevant to me. So like the point is, you may have had one good conversation, or two maybe, but you didn't really learn as much as you had hoped to learn from the whole session, and you wonder what insights you might have missed on all those other posters you didn't have time to get to. So this all kind of sucks for you when you walk around trying to learn from the posters, and it also sucks when you're the presenter trying to make an impact with your poster that nobody's looking at. But there's something much more sinister going wrong here, and that's that when you're walking around trying to learn from this poster session, and you're only able to interact with one or two posters, you're missing all the insight from the posters you had to breeze by and skim. And these missed insights are all like part of your field. You're supposed to know all of this stuff. A lot of them probably apply to the scientific problems you're wrestling with in some direct or tangential way, and you're missing them. You're only getting like one or two points before time runs out and you gotta leave. So not only are poster sessions kind of a lackluster experience for everybody involved, but they're also really inefficient at transferring knowledge to people walking through the poster sessions. And that means it's slowing down the learning. It's slowing down scientific progress, which is actually holding the human race back in a non-insignificant way. That sounds like hyperbole, but I actually mean it. Maybe the research in your field isn't very important, and I'm in psychology, so I get that. But if you're studying something that people are suffering from, like cancer or Alzheimer's or ME/CFS, like one of those missed posters could contain some finding you hadn't thought about that triggers a moment of insight that helps you cure that disease sooner than you would have if you had missed that poster. And all of these missed insights are happening en masse in every single field of science right now. This isn't just a design frustration, this is a serious problem and a serious opportunity. I think a lot of these problems come down to the way we approach designing academic posters. So let's see if we can fix that. Okay, so here's how the poster design process works, if you can call it a design process. 6 months before the conference, you write an essay talking about your research findings that you want to put on your poster. And then you submit that to the conference, and then hopefully it gets approved, and then you're happy because that means your school will pay for your travel. And then you forget about it for like 5 months, until about 2 weeks before the conference. And while you're already worrying about everything else you have to do for the conference, plane tickets, packing, things like that, it suddenly hits you and you're like, oh, shit. I actually have to create the damn poster. Crap. And then you get like really idealistic. You're like, you know what? I'm gonna make this the best poster ever. You open a blank PowerPoint file and get started. And then like an hour later, you're like, crap, nothing's done and this is going nowhere. And I need to get this done to the printer by 2 tomorrow and I don't have time to do this perfectionistic crap. I need something done now. It doesn't make me look stupid. So you desperately email one of your senior grad student friends and they're like, no problem, I got you covered. Here's a poster design I always use. It was handed down to me by Susie. Oh, you never got to meet Susie. She was one of the senior students that graduated before you got here. It was like 4 years ago. Susie was amazing. Anyway, this is the design I always use. It works for me. Hope it helps. And you're like, great. It's perfect. And what you're really thinking is like, I don't have time to be original here. I just gotta get this done to the printer, and it's my first year of grad school or whatever, and I'm kind of afraid of looking unprofessional or looking like I don't know what I'm doing. I don't have really time to think this through. So what do you do in times of uncertainty? You mimic. You copy somebody else, and that makes you feel safe. So you open up your friend's template, and then whatever is on that old hand-me-down poster design, you copy. Like whatever they did, you do. If they had their entire introduction paragraph copy and pasted in this tiny box in the corner, then that's what you do. You take your entire introduction paragraph and you put it in that little box. If they display like their full table of correlation coefficients that don't all really relate to like what their central points are, then that's what you put in. You put in all your correlation coefficients. That uses up space. And then what you end up with is this monstrosity of a wall of text poster with like copy and pasted bits of your essay squeezed into these templated old boxes with like your school's faded header on top from its 25-year-old branding scheme. And your poster just looks like a wall of mess. And some part of you is like, is this legible? Like, nobody can read this. But that part's very quiet. The very much louder part is like, good, it looks great. And it looks great because it looks like I did something. It looks like I spent longer on this than the rushed hour that I actually spent on it. Now, if you have a little extra time on your hands, you may be able to listen to that let's make this a little more readable voice. And if you have that kind of time, maybe you like add a nice graph or turn one section of text into bullet points or something like that, or add a picture. And I've done this. When I first started my PhD program, I tried to take an extra hour with a poster and improve the usability of it a little bit. So here's one of my first posters. I had like a so what box and icons and pictures for everything, but it's still just a wall of text in the same old format. And then there are these like unicorn posters. These are the posters that you see one of at every conference if you're lucky, and they're beautiful. They're like infographics, and they're designed by either like professional applied firms or grad students who were designers before coming to grad school, or they use templates or paint something. And these infographic style posters make you feel completely inadequate. You're like, man, my poster should look like that. That's a good poster. But they're still not. Like, they're still just a wall of pretty things you can't interpret very quickly. And their cardinal sin is that they expect people to be up close and reading them. The cardinal sin of every poster I've seen, including the posters I've designed myself, is that we assume people are gonna like stand there and read our posters in silence for 10 straight minutes, following the order of the sections we laid out. And when we design them, we're sitting up close to them, reading them in order, so we design them for that kind of user experience. For a context that's really different from how people actually read posters at poster sessions. Really, the accurate way to design your poster based on how they're actually used would be to project your PowerPoint file on a wall at like full size and walk past it over and over again and improve the design for the experience of learning while walking by. But none of us do that. Like, watch. Here are beautiful infographic style posters. They're gonna move past you at walking speed. Try to read them. Did you catch anything besides the title? Did you even catch the title? To learn anything from the infographic format, you have to walk up and spend a lot of time with it, because that's what infographics are designed for. They're designed to sustain your attention while you're right up next to it for 5 to 10 minutes, reading it on your own in silence. Infographics aren't the right goal for scientific posters, because we just don't spend that much time with most posters. If anything, a billboard is a better design analogy, because those are designed to transmit information as you move past them. So what should an academic poster look like? I think an ideal academic poster should accomplish 3 goals. First, we want to maximize the amount of insight transferred to attendees in the poster session. If you're attending a poster session, we want to make it easy for you to interact with every poster in some way, so that you could conceivably learn the insight that every single poster in the session has to offer in less than 50 minutes. Second, we want to keep the good stuff. We still want to leave time for having good conversations and getting deep insight about any single poster if you want to. And third, we have to accomplish these goals in a way that is as lazy or lazier for grad students and scientists to create posters with the new design, under time pressure, and with no free mental bandwidth. Even if this new approach to designing posters cures cancer faster, if it's not easier for scientists to create than what they're currently doing, it'll never happen. So we have to make it easy so that it's both the right way to do it and the fast way to do it. So let's get started. Okay, so let's get into the right frame of mind here. We're gonna start things off with one of the most famous quotes in all of design. Here it goes. Perfection is not when you have nothing to add. It's when you have nothing to take away. Good designs start with something very, very minimal, like a core thing, and they work from there. So that's what we're gonna do. And for that core thing, we're gonna follow the biggest, most reliable rule in all of usability research. You put a lot of effort into what people need to know, and then you include the stuff that's nice to know last. Punchline first. So here's a blank academic poster. What is the minimum need-to-know piece of information that should go on here if we could only put one thing on it? Well, that's probably like the main finding of the study, right? So we need a finding. I'm gonna use a real finding from my friend Jacob's study. Jacob very bravely sent me his poster and let me use it for the video. Thank you, Jacob. And you probably can't tell from this poster, but Jacob's study is actually really cool and important. But that coolness and that importance is lost in this traditional academic poster format. So we're gonna take this and we're gonna redesign it. And we're gonna start by grabbing the main finding, the core takeaway of this study, and putting it on our blank poster. So let's see, what's the main finding of this study? What's the main finding? See, this is the problem I'm talking about. It's taken me way too damn long to find the main takeaway from this study, which is pretty representative of the problem here. And that has nothing to do with this poster. Every poster in science is like this. Okay, so after reading this entire poster, I think the main finding is this bit right here. We found consistent differential validity for some non-cognitive measures for predicting international student GPA, specifically with SJTs, continuous learning, social responsibility, and perseverance. So let's put that on the poster. And then we're gonna change the background color. You can use your school's color if you want to, but I think it would be extra efficient to use colors that prime people's expectations about what type of poster they're about to see, because they'll notice the color first. Like, we could use green for empirical studies because they're the most common, blue for theory, red for methods, and yellow, the most attention-getting color, for that rare and wonderful intervention study. So this is already better, but it sounds kind of technical to anybody who doesn't specialize in the subfield that this relates to, which is selection or hiring decisions. Which is fine for an academic paper where people can go back and look up terms they don't know. But we don't have that kind of time. People are walking by in 5 seconds, we gotta punch it in their brain. And research on usability writing shows that plain language is interpreted faster and gets people's attention better. So the most efficient thing we can put on this poster is actually a plain language version of our main finding. So we're going to say, for international students, perseverance and a sense of social responsibility are extra important for predicting first-year GPA. Now this kind of makes sense, right? Now you're getting this whole story popping into your mind. But what if we're presenting a poster and somebody comes up and asks us a question we don't know the answer to, like give me your full list of predictors and all the correlations? What about those figures and tables that give us that sense of safety and the ability to answer questions? Well, for that, we're gonna add something called an ammo bar. Ammo bar is just gonna be a column on the right side, or whatever side you plan to stand on. And you're gonna copy and paste all of your miscellaneous figures and tables and stuff that you need for answering questions into that bar. You're not gonna spend any time worrying about the design or layout of this section because it's just for you to use. Treat it as your scratchboard. Make it as ugly and as fast as you can. It's just there so you can point to things when somebody walks up and talks to you. Now, what if you're already talking to somebody and you're showing them things in your ammo bar and somebody else walks up and wants to learn more about your study, but doesn't want to interrupt you? Well, for them, we're gonna add a sidebar on the left. We're gonna call this our silent presenter bar. In the silent presenter bar, you're gonna do all the stuff you normally do on an academic poster, but you're gonna worry about the layout of it a little less. Go ahead and follow the old intro methods results format. Copy and paste bits of your essay or add bullets and graphs if you have time. Just sort of give people an overview of the paper as if they were going to be standing there and reading it silently, but in 1 to 4 minutes, not 10 to 15. These sidebars are key to this design because with the ammo bar and the silent presenter bar together, we really have almost as much information on this new design as we had on the traditional design. It's just arranged much more efficiently. But what if somebody wants a lot more information? A lot more than you can even put on your poster, and doesn't have time to read it or talk to you. These are the people that sometimes like snap pictures of your poster. Well, for these people, we're gonna add a QR code that links to your full paper and a copy of the poster. These QR codes look scary, but they are stupidly easy to create. Just Google create a QR code, you'll do it in a second. And every phone can read them. Like if you take out your phone right now and take a picture of this QR code on the screen, it'll automatically know it's taking a picture of a QR code and follow the link. So this last QR code feature lets you snap a picture of any poster and instantly get a copy of the whole poster and the paper. So now with this QR code option, we're actually providing an option to get even more information than traditional designs allow for, and doing it in a way that lets attendees choose how much information they want to get instead of being flooded. In design, this is called the principle of progressive disclosure. So here's our final design. Now there are more things we could do with this. Like if you have a really important graph or an image that needs to go in the center, you could move the QR code over. It only needs to be about 5 inches big to be read. You could also add your own creative flair with images and stuff. But for now, let's look at the design in its simplest form. Let's look at a before and after. So in the next screen, a few real academic posters are gonna move past you at a walking pace. See how much information you can absorb. Now try these same posters you just saw translated to the new design. Now this is gonna be a little unbelievable and jarring at first, because when people see this, they don't believe that these clear findings came from the posters they just saw, but they did. This is how detached current scientific poster design is from actually communicating what you need to know. Here we go. You absorbed more, right? You got the gist of probably every poster. And if you wanted to know more, you could still walk up and talk or read the silent presenter bar or just scan the QR code and keep walking. So this new design meets our goals. It helps transfer insight more efficiently by leading with the main finding and making it big and obvious and in plain language. You can still walk up and have good conversations with people. And for our third goal, and I hope you can tell from looking at it, but this approach is way easier for grad students to create. You can create this poster design in much less time than you're spending on your current method. So let's look at the presenter experience. Now, everybody who walks by looks at your poster, at least, because looking at your poster is less effortful and it's more rewarding to look, which is already an improvement. And now people who walk by can engage with your poster quickly by snapping a QR code, which still makes you feel good if you see somebody do it. And you still get those conversations, perhaps even more of them because your hook is better. And now look at the attendee experience. You get that feeling of breathing and insight as you walk past. And you have more options as an attendee to choose your level of engagement with posters you're interested in. You don't have to get trapped in a conversation to learn something from a poster. And look at how it could accelerate learning. You can conceivably walk into a poster session with this design and learn something from every single poster instead of just one or two. If every scientist in every field used a design like this instead of the crappy old wall of text template they're using right now, it could accelerate insight and discovery and be more fun for everybody. The reason I spent a year of my life making this cartoon instead of publishing papers like I'm supposed to be doing is because I really think that if everybody uses a design like this, we could accelerate the pace of science. We could cure all diseases slightly sooner, and that's everything to the people suffering from them. I really believe in this design. I know it's jarringly different than what you're used to using, but for what it's worth, when actual designers design posters and billboards, their first advice is to keep it simple and be comfortable with negative space, which this design really does.
And that brings us to the end of the video on poster presentation for conferences. Stay tuned for more educational videos on English for academic writing.